just unbearable. So they took the lesson, they switched on the television, and they got everything sent by mail, exams, courses, etc. So this is nothing new. The point is that right now we have not many choices, right? So I was telling you physical separation, but in here, teachers, the main objective in here would be facilitating communication between the teacher and students. And this implies that we have to work a little bit harder in refining our presentation skills. But anyway, I will go there in just one or two more seconds. So some other names that you may find in here whenever we're talking about distance education are the ones that you can see right now on screen. This would be one of them, video conferencing, which is pretty much what I am doing right now, right? I'm speaking in front of a camera. I'm speaking to a microphone with my headset, and I have people listening through different media. So this could be one possibility. Another one that you may find, this can be synchronized, and it can be also pre-recorded, which means that, for example, right now, everything is going live, right? I'm speaking, and it's, as I said, it's via this media, via FaceTime, I believe. But another possibility would be if I had recorded all of these sessions previously, and I simply press the button of play, and you can simply hear to everything I have to say. That is possible. People on the TV, they do that. People on the radio, they also do that. So it's nothing new. And the point in here is mentioning this because at certain point, if you feel a little bit, uncomfortable or a little bit shy of speaking to a camera, a very good option would be to have a video of yourself speaking so you can study it. You can see your facial expression. You can see your gestures. You can see, you can hear to yourselves, and you can start making changes so it can be better in your opinion. I go to the third bulletin here, and it says open schedule online courses. This means, and some governments are doing this right now, that you can access any time that you like, right? In such a way that there is no fixed schedule. And this is very convenient because sometimes some students have to work. So they have, limited time to get online and to start working. Another one would be one thing that you may have heard or overheard in the last few weeks, a hybrid model in which we have a possibility of going to school, be face-to-face in a class with my students, and do the practice, probably homework, probably exams online. Do you call this a hybrid model education? Another name for this would be blended learning as well. Another possibility would be the one that I'm highlighting right now, computer-based education. And this means that there is no teacher, but everything is going to be done by software. There are plenty of programs that are working like that. And another one, which is very much what we're doing right now, is a fixed time course. Yeah, you get an invitation, you switch on, and you get online at a fixed time, and then we start working. So teachers, this would be some of the varieties that you're going to find whenever we're working with distance education. But today the point is talking about the flipped classroom. So let's talk about the flipped classroom. And if I have had already the wonderful opportunity of meeting you and working with you, you may remember that I love starting everything with a question. So the question here is, what is the flipped classroom? Yep. And why is this? Because the idea is to start exercising and flexing a little bit the analytical muscle of everybody and think about what you have heard, what you know, what you suppose, or what you assume flipped classroom is. Unfortunately, we have no chance of being together. If we did, which we don't, I would ask you to do something, raise your hand, clap your hands, snap your fingers, and tell me if you think the flipped classroom is a pedagogy, or if, in your opinion, it is a theory, or if it is an instructional method, or as many things that we know, if it is only a teaching fashion. Unfortunately, we are not together, so I have to skip this part of the interaction, and I have to go to the answer. So surprise, surprise, the flipped classroom, and I'm going to highlight the negative part. It is not a pedagogy. It is not an instructional method. It is not a theory. So we have no for the previous bullets. The second part, there is no right way to flip your class. So the question here would be, if there is no right way to flip your class, what on earth am I doing with this, right? But don't worry, I'm getting there in a second more. And last but not least, to work a little bit more with despair, there is no panel of experts to tell you what to do. Actually, when I started doing research for this, I'm not going to tell you for what, but for the flipped classroom, I started doing some research, and actually information is a little bit limited, but again, I will get there in a second. So if we say that it is not a pedagogy, it's not a bit, well, I'm not going to tell you why, because this is going too deep. It's not a pedagogy, not an instructional method, and not a theory. Then the question is, what is it? Let's find out. Before we go into the flipped classroom, we have to go into the flipped mindset. So teachers, the question is, what is the flipped mindset? And before I go into the part of flipped, the question would be working with this phrase, mindset. Mindset is connected to the way we see things, to, believe it or not, there is also a synonym, sometimes you use it as paradigm, as a set of ideas, as your concept, your beliefs, and many different things that we apply when we are working and when we are teaching. So therefore, as you're reading already, the flipped mindset is not something that you do, but something that you have, something that you strongly believe in, and something that is connected very much with the way you teach. You know, there is one thing that is called teaching style, and every teacher has a style. And we teach very much because of the experiences that we have had as students and when we started teaching as well. So all of this is to lead us to the next question. What is making up the flipped mindset? And for these teachers, I need to change my slide and tell you what the experts say. Well, this is, it is one expert, Crystal Kirch. So she says that the flipped mindset is made up of three big steps. Number one, I have to make the best of my face-to-face time with my students. What is the meaning of this? Sometimes we go in class and we start explaining the basics all the time to my students. I start reminding them of everything, pronunciation, rules, perhaps a little bit or a little more than a little bit of grammar. And when I turn around, I have only 10 minutes to work on my content. So the general sensation is that I did not use my time properly. So this would be like the first part. How can I make the best when I'm working or facing my students? And this, teachers, this point number one applies also to distance learning. If my class is limited and I only have 1 hour, 45 minutes, an hour and 30 minutes, I have to make the best of that time. So my instruction has to be very clear and very explicit. This would be the first part. Second part, learner-centered. By the way, this is British English spelling, just in case that you were wondering. So the learner-centered approach, teacher, was born in the late 70s in England. And at least on my recall here in Latin America, we started speaking about student-centered or learner-centered approach or approaches or methodologies around the late 80s, early 90s. But what's the meaning of this? It means that in this case, and from this perspective, my students become responsible for the learning process. Many years ago, the students would sit down, listen to the teacher, say yes, do the homework, end of the story. But in here, the idea is that they are active, they participate, they ask questions, and they do something, not just sitting down and passively waiting for the teacher to do all the job. After all, teachers know English. Students are the ones who are learning English, right? So this would be like the second part. So students are responsible for the learning process. They have to be awake, they have to be active and they have to participate. My responsibility as a teacher is to facilitate learning. And facilitate is a wonderful word that was used extremely quite widely in the early 90s. They said that now the teacher was not an educator, but was a facilitator. So the question is, what does this mean? And it means that I have, as a teacher, to set everything for my students to learn. I have to give them a situation, I have to show them the tools, I have to explain them the strategies, and I have to guide them through the process so they can do all the work and all the thinking. And last but not least, here I have the last point. It says, focus on high-level thinking. So it would be lovely if we had the time and we started analyzing the meaning of the word thinking. What is thinking? But unfortunately, again, we do not have that much time. So teachers, I'm going to limit this to two acrostics. And please be patient with me, because here is where you can see that I'm old enough to be really bad at trying to scribble anything on the screen. So far, so good. So first big concept is LOTS, or low order thinking skills. Allow me to make a question from a TOEFL test. What does a man mean? Answer: low order thinking skill is the one that is regularly based on memory work, things that you recall, things that you have like as an immediate response for something. But on the other hand, we have the HOTS. And this is connected to my high order thinking skills. Yeah, and this is precisely what I'm pointing out right here on the screen. So high level thinking skill, the ability to, for example, make a list, compare, contrast, predict, and give a sense of priority. And now, teachers, I'm talking about critical thinking skills, right? In other words, I'm not just going to sit down and believe everything the teacher says, but now I have to do something with language, because language is for communication. So basically speaking, teachers, this would be the point. What am I doing when I am teaching? Am I asking my students to memorize a set of words or a set of phrases so they can use it whenever they need it? Because that worked, but that worked many years ago. Or am I going to teach them how to think a little bit, which are the strategies, and how I can make, how I can get information from my different sources? Yeah, this could be... I'm sorry, Patty or Lodena, can you help me with the noise? Thank you. So I was telling you, or am I going to give them like all the necessary tools so they can start using, understanding language and using it? So let me go to the next slide. So for the flipped classroom, if you do a little bit of research, you're going to find the pillars, four pillars. So you have them over here. Let me just point out what each and every one of these icons mean. Point number one, it would be flexibility, a flexible environment. When I speak about flexibility, it means the possibility of giving my students a certain degree of openness for when and where learning can take place. I mentioned a few seconds ago the situation when students have to work. Yeah, or students have to do something else, so they may have limited time. So this could be like one possibility. But in here, I also have to have a certain degree of flexibility in my expectations. You know that many years ago, everything was measured against a very rigid standard. And nowadays, we have a different trend. Now we're speaking about competence-based education, which means that we have to consider which is the starting point of students so they can get, so I can get to know how much he or she has improved. And in order to do that, I have to do like a number of different things. But anyway, so as I was telling you, this would be the first part of flexibility. Point number two, a learning culture. Yeah, what's the meaning of this? As I was telling you, students are expected to become active in the process. They have to participate actively. They have to think a little bit. They have to ask questions. They have to advance a little bit. And nowadays, teachers, you know, that there's new generations, especially when you talk about, you know, concept about science, about math, you find students that Google everything the teacher says, and then they may confirm or usually reject or say something different because they found it in Google. So this would be the first part. So they become more active. Yeah. And I'm going to be concentrating not only on the concept, but also on how well they perform and how many things I have to correct. The next part, I love this one. Yeah, I'm actually going to try and highlight the light bulb. And this one, teachers, stands for intentional. The intentional teacher, the intentional teaching, the intentional content. Again, what's the meaning of this? Simple, teachers. Yeah, it means that whatever we're going to teach, we do it in a deliberate way. So I know that I have my content, but I also know that I also know the situation for my students. I also know what they need. Therefore, I can start directing part of the content in such a way my students can get most of the benefit or most of the practice. And this would be the idea. If I decide, because I can decide, if I decide how I'm going to deliver my content so my students benefit from this, then one, I'm going to do the best. I'm going to maximize my time with my students. And second, I'm going to make it as effective as possible for them. Yeah. So this would be the third point. And last but not least, here, I'm going to do my best to highlight this figure, which stands for the teacher. Here, I'm speaking about the professional educator. What's the meaning of this? Simple, teachers. We have to, as I told you a second ago, we have to update, let's use the word update the mindset. And instead of just covering from page 1 to page 5 or 6 or 7 in a book, I decide what I want my students to learn. As I was telling you, yeah, all my delivery is going to be intentional. Therefore, I can become a professional educator in the sense that I can have a look at my students, I can observe them, and I can give them very specific feedback. And in this case, my role in the class is going to be less prominent. I'm going to let them speak because that's what I want to know. I want to see them speak. I want to see them write. I want to see them respond to input, to listening and to reading and to interaction. And from that, I can offer feedback. If my feedback is constructive, then I'm actually working on a lot of different possibilities with my students. So teachers, these are some of the ideas in here, the four pillars. Let's continue. So the question is, teachers, are you ready to flip? And one more time, if we had had the chance, I would have sent this link to you, or well, I would have asked probably the staff from Maya, Patty, Lorena. Lorena is the one who's in charge of most of these things. So you could actually have a look at these videos, but we do not have that chance. So this is what we're going to do. We're going to watch these two videos, and then I'm going to ask a couple of questions, and then we're going to compare them. And please notice what I am doing right here, because I'm going to go back to this in a second. Yeah, and then we discuss. Okay, so I'm going to change my screen right now. And here we go.
I've been teaching math for the last 5 years, and this is why I flipped my classroom. This is what my classroom used to look like. I was teaching to the middle group of the class, the students that could follow along with what we were doing and we were going through the content, while I had a group of higher level students not challenged, bored with the information, ready to move forward. And I had a struggling group of students that were not receiving enough effective remediation. They didn't have the basic content they needed to be working on the content we were currently covering, or they needed more help in order to be successful. This led to a 90% use of class time being spent on delivery and review of content. 90% of the time I was at the front of the classroom lecturing to a group of students, and I wasn't meeting all of their needs. 10% of class time was actually spent on application, which led to depending on students to do the application needed to be successful. They had to go home or outside of class and work on applying the concepts that I was giving out in class. This constant battle of not reaching the needs of all students and feeling the need to differentiate for all of my learners allows teachers to feel overwhelmed and ineffective, because we see the need for differentiation, but there's just not enough time for effective differentiation. This called for a drastic change in how we teach. This is where flipping the classroom comes in. Now the students outside of class preload the content. They get the information they're going to need for class. They can pause, rewind, and rewatch the videos as many times as they need to. They can post questions online to their classmates or to the teacher. And it's a self-paced program where they can be remediated by going back and reviewing former topics, or they can work ahead when they've already mastered a concept and are ready to look forward. They get the content here before class, so that when they come into class, my whole classroom has now shifted, where I'm at the center of the class, working between these differentiated groups focused on different pieces of application. I can now work between each of these groups that are moving at their own pace. This has created a 90% use of class time spent on application of the content, and 10% of class time is spent on delivery of content, when I can answer questions that have been posted or take any other questions that have come up from applying the content. Now in my classroom, all students are engaged and challenged. I have time to work with
All right, so teachers, now you saw a little bit of the video. Yeah, and in here, the point would be asking some questions. So, question number one. In here, the idea would be, so, what does she teach? And the answer, she teaches math. What was her problem? The problem is that she spent 90% of the time teaching the basics to students, and her gifted and talented students would be bored, and the other students would be like struggling. What does she say? That if she starts working, and I'm going to go back to the video part. Yeah, if she starts working with the video, I'm going to go back a little bit. Here we go. She says they can pause, they can rewind, they can rewatch, and they can make a lot of questions. So if you notice in here, she says 90% of class time is spent on application. 10% is spent on delivery. So teachers, this would be like part of the basic difference. Anyway, I'm going to go back. This, I am sorry, is a little bit of cheating, because the idea would be to have you watch this lovely math teacher for as many times as you consider it necessary, and then I can start discussing. But we're limited of time, so we have to teach with what we have. So my apologies for this. Let me go back to this part. Excellent. So we did the first video already, and I told you this teacher was a teacher of math, right? Let's continue. So in here, the idea would be that you watch the video, then you would have to summarize the video, and last but not least, you would have to ask questions about that. That is the whole idea. You can watch the video as many times as possible. Yeah, and of course, you have to make notes out of this. Yeah, because it is not passive watching. It's not like being a couch potato, but you know, taking out information, because that is the point. Now, this point, teachers, was a little bit tricky many years ago. But now you know that you have YouTube, and most of students, we know that they go to YouTube for a lot of tutorials. And actually, a tutorial is very much like a step-by-step guide to do different things. From you know, how to make... how to cook something, because believe it or not, you have students that are actually watching that, to how to play certain piece of music in a guitar. And I can tell you that because my son does that quite often. So this could be the point. Now for my class, this is the best part. asking questions. Why? When a student is making a question, I know a student is thinking, especially if it is a good question. If the question is like one connected to the topic or two, well elaborated, it means that there is somebody who is thinking. Yeah, so this is what you would have to do. And teachers, I'm going to change my slide a second time. And I'm going to let you watch the second video. Yeah, and I'm going to play a trick. Yeah, I'm going to let you watch the video once. And then right after that, I'm going to give you a few seconds and I'm going to watch it. I'm going to replay it again. So you can work a little bit on your summary. And if there were any questions, you can post it in the chat. Let's see if that can work today for us. So I'm going back and here we go.
This is a classroom. The teacher stands at the front and the students watch and listen. You'll recognize this because it's probably how you were taught and how your parents were taught before you. But there are a lot of problems with this approach to teaching. You see, not all students learn at the same speed. So some get left behind. And while some students learn better by listening, others may learn better by doing. This means that teachers can't always do the best job they can. But there is another way. The flipped classroom addresses these problems and makes learning more personal. First, the teacher makes a video that delivers the content they'd usually teach in class. Then they share it online with students who can watch it before the next lesson. This leaves the teacher free to spend class time leading activities that help students apply the knowledge. Students can rewind and rewatch a video as many times as they like and come back to class with questions for the teacher. So keeping up with the class is no longer an issue. Students can access the video at any time using mobile devices, giving them the ability to learn more independently. Instead of sitting and listening, students can spend class time applying knowledge in more practical ways. And teachers are free to spend their time working with students and giving them individual support and attention. The flipped classroom model is already making a difference to students and teachers worldwide. So get involved. Discover more at flippedinstitute.org and become part of the movement.
All right. So you have already watched it. And I'm going to let you watch a little bit of this again, not everything, because that is time consuming and it may turn a little bit exhausting. Yeah, so let's go for it one more time.
This is a classroom. The teacher stands at the front and the students watch and listen. You'll recognize this because it's probably how you were taught and how your parents were taught before you. But there are a lot of problems with this approach to teaching. You see, not all students learn at the same speed. So some get left behind. And while some students learn better by listening, others may learn better by doing. This means that teachers can't always do the best job they can. But there is another way. The flipped classroom addresses these problems and makes learning more personal. First, the teacher makes a video that delivers the content they'd usually teach in class. Then they share it online with students who can watch it before the next lesson. This leaves the teacher free to spend class time leading activities that help students apply the knowledge. Students can rewind and rewatch a video as many times as they like and come back to class with questions for the teacher. So keeping up with the class is no longer an issue. Students can access the video at any time using mobile devices, giving them the ability to learn more independently. Instead of sitting and listening, students can spend class time applying knowledge in more practical ways. And teachers are free to spend their time working with students and giving them individual support and attention.
Right, so in here, teachers, you saw two different types of video, right? And this would be some questions that we would have to answer. But anyway, I will have to do all the guidance. Forgive me. So let's have a look. Question number one, who made the video? In the first case, it was the teacher. And I don't know if you noticed, but every time the teacher, I'm going to go back. I'm sorry. Let me just, here we go. One, two. If you notice in here, she's actually shifting the cardboards and everything was handwritten and she's speaking directly to the camera, right? This would be like the first part. Over here, you see that there's a lot of production. I mean, you know, the walrus is lovely. The penguins are absolutely fantastic and all the animation. And there is music and of course the narrator is, it has like a very specific way of using her voice and so on. Yeah, so this would be like one of the differences. How long is the video? In the case of the teacher, the math teacher is a little bit more than 3 minutes. On in the case of the penguins and the walrus, this would be somewhere around a minute and a half, maybe 2 minutes. The next question I will have to answer to you. What do you expect viewers to do after watching the video? Simple. If we had the time to be together, or if this were a class, I would post a couple of questions and I would expect you to, one, answer the questions and two, make some questions of your own after watching the video. In here, my big question would be, what can I do if my students do not know how to proceed? And if you notice, teachers, this is exactly what I am doing right now. Yeah, I'm going back and forth in my PowerPoint and I am telling you part of the process. Next, can we do something similar with our teaching concepts? Where's my marker? Here it is. So can we do something similar with what we teach? The answer has to be yes, of course. Yeah, but we have a problem. Again, let me go back. One, two. She teaches math. And the walrus teaches science. And we teach English. So I know that you may not remember this, but in both videos, they speak a little bit about the concept. So they can review the concepts. If I'm speaking about, I don't know, for instance, algebra, or if I'm speaking about trigonometry or any other concept, I would have to explain perhaps the formula, the uses, etc. I mean, here, if I'm speaking about science, and that was earth science, I'm sorry. One second, please. Can somebody help me? Thank you very much. Thanks a lot. So, and here, this is about earth science. You saw a volcano. Actually, here, there is a volcano, right? So it would be explaining everything connected to the concept. Now, teachers, in our case, we speak about teaching English. So we go to the next question. What would you flip? Most likely, it would be grammar, right? And I'm not a wizard, teachers. It's just experience. So chances are that we would be trying to flip grammar, perhaps a little bit of pronunciation. But the grammar would be most likely the best, the immediate thing we would like to flip. Yeah, so when I started working on this some years ago, I actually found some references. There is an expert on this, because she's actually a teacher of science, Crystal Kitch. And she has written most of the articles and done most of the work connected to flipped classroom. So I sent her an email and I started asking her questions and she was kind enough to answer. And my question was, Crystal, how can I apply the flipped classroom if I am teaching English to non-speakers of English? So she gave me a number of ideas that I'm going to share with you in the following slides. But in the meantime, let us continue. So after all of this, I told you it is not a pedagogy. It is not a teaching method. It is not a teaching fashion. What is a flipped classroom? Let's have a look. It took me a long time to do it this way, teachers. It is a pedagogical model. So point number one, if I say that this, where's my cursor? Sorry, I'm getting a little bit colorblind, my apologies. If it is a model, it means it is very much like a way of teaching, okay? I'm not going to go too deep into the part of the definition. That is not important at this point. Yeah, but it's very much the way I teach. But look at this, the typical lecture. Yeah, lecture does not really apply for English teachers because there are some infamous exceptions, but we do not lecture our students. We show them how to use language. But in here, my content are reversed. Yeah, my elements are reversed. Where's my cursor again? Here we go. My elements are reversed. What's the meaning of this? It means that instead of explaining everything in class, I have my students go to the web and find information. And of course, my information, sorry about that, my information has to be connected to my topic. It has to be connected to everything. Otherwise, my students would be finding something that may not be a part of my class. So, at this point, and this is part of what was actually seen in the videos, yeah, my students have different learning styles. You saw it in the part of the penguins. Some of them are visual, some of them are auditory, some of them learn better when they do thing that is called kinesthesia. Yeah, some of my students may miss important part of my class. Some of them may be absent and miss critical lessons. Yeah, most of them, I'm not going to say some, may forget. Yeah, and I would say that the new generations tend very much to forget because they live very much the very moment. Yeah, so if I want them to remember all of this, and if I want to address the different learning styles, flipping my class would be a very useful possibility. Why? Because my students are going to be in charge of watching the video as many times as they want. They can, as you were listening from the first video with the math teacher, they can play, pause, rewind, repeat as many times. And of course, the main point would be that my video has to be short enough so they can watch it as many times as they can. My son was just telling me a couple of days ago, probably last week, that he was a little bit distraught because he had to watch a video. And the video said 15 minutes in the life of an electron. That was for science. Yeah, and he said the video turns out to be more than 21 minutes long. So that is too much for students. And they can get lost and they can get bored. And actually being bored is even worse than being lost. Because if they are lost, they can get back. But if they are bored, we have to work extra. So this would be like some of the concepts. Short videos connected to the topic. Up to this point, everything is going to look so clear, I believe. So in here you see brick phase, traditional learning. Here we teach in class and my students work in isolation. But if I flip my class, it can be adapted to what I'm living right now, which is distance learning. I can start actually guiding discussions and connection. This can be via a chat. I don't really have to discuss with my students. I can make a post. And if they post challenges on Facebook or they do silly things on TikTok, yeah, they can also respond to very simple and very well-designed questions in my class. Yeah, and I can be more actively involved in the part of supporting my students, clarifying any kind of doubt. And this is a word that you saw very clearly because the teacher of math said this more than 5 times. And actually, she had it written, differentiation. What is differentiation? Teachers, before I go on in here, this is not a concept that is very commonly applied in Latin America. Why not? Because this is regularly done for people who are studying in English-speaking countries. This goes very much with English learners. But it applies for everybody. Differentiation means that I'm going to consider that in my students, in my classroom, I will have students that are at the level I will have students that are above the level, and I will have students that are below the level. And this is what you call a mixed ability classroom. And in here, if I can detect my, some teachers used to call this the gifted and the talented. In the case of English, it's very simple. Maybe mom and dad speak English. Maybe they went to a private school. Maybe they have relatives who speak English. Maybe they have traveled to any English-speaking country. It could be the US, Canada, the United Kingdom, or any other place. So they can be faster in the part of learning, understanding, and responding. And I may also have students that did not, were not this lucky. They did not have that instruction. Maybe they did not even have instruction at all. So if I can find that difference, then I can start addressing them to very specific needs. I'm going to change my screen for a second to go back to the first video, the one of the teacher, so I can illustrate this part. So in here, actually, let me just go back a little bit. Here we go. And let me point everything in here. So you will notice, she says 90% of my class is going to be spent on application. In the case of math, it would be probably problem solving or, you know, working out with problems and formulas. But in the case of English, this would be reading and responding, listening and responding, writing something, speaking something, interacting and doing everything that we are supposed to do with English, right? Yeah, and it says 10%, oh, I'm sorry about that, 10% of my class on delivery of content, and this would be explanation. So if my students watch a video, and I said a second ago, most likely this is going to be connected to grammar, then I can check the questions and I can start having them show me how they can apply that grammar concept or that grammar rule or that Mom? Grammar topic. Yeah. No. Oh, maybe.
Ay, ¿cuándo sales de la barriga?
Can somebody help me silence that microphone? Thank you. Please, teachers, notice how the classroom is illustrated as follows. Look at this. Students that are at level. This is supposed to be the teacher. She says she's at the center of her class. Students that are above level and students that may be below level. So this would be very much the concept. When I do differentiation, it means that I work with my different students, speaking about the levels of understanding and response with different kind of activities. There is a special session for this, so I'm not going to go any further, but in here, summarizing it would be that I can try and reach each and every one of my students through feedback. Okay, so as I was telling you a second ago, this would be like the nice part of the presentation, right? This is like, yeah, it makes a lot of sense. It looks very pretty. Excellent. Yeah, but let me continue. Yeah, the benefits. I mentioned this before. If they are absent, if my lesson goes a little bit too fast, it may. If the content is too easy, they get bored. If it is too difficult, they get frustrated. If they forget, they always do. They can always go back to the web, watch the video, and bingo. And we know that most of our students are like that. They forget the basics. They have to be reminded constantly. Of course, this means that my students are expected to be active and responsible, which means that they are going to be in charge of their own learning process. Again, what does the man mean? Again, it means that my students are going to be responsible of switching on, connecting, doing the homework, doing some research, watching the video as many times as necessary. Yeah, watching, summarizing, and making questions. Probably you do not remember, but the math teacher said they can post the questions for me or they can ask between each other, so they can start getting all the information. Teachers, let's face it. Every time you tell students do not copy, they are sending a text message or a WhatsApp. Yeah, because they are always connected. So we can benefit from that part. Yeah, and my students are supposed to be working on what they need. If they need more grammar, they work on grammar. If they said, teacher, I need to improve my pronunciation, so I can give my student a strategy, for example, shadow listening, and he or she can watch a video and watch it again as many times as necessary, so they can also start working on this part. And of course, the idea is that they can manage their own time. Of course, they need to be guided, because it is not as simple as that they're going to be doing this. Yeah, but that's going to be my part in this side that I was telling you is called facilitating, right? I can hint them, I can give them some advice, and of course, I can remind them, because we have to remind them constantly. Okay, so these are some of the benefits. And again, all up to this point, everything looks logical. Yeah, it makes a lot of sense. This teacher is Crystal Kirch, and she says, I don't believe a flipped classroom is something in which my students receive direct instruction at home and work on worksheets in class. In other words, let's try to stay away from having them simply answer something online, and that is the flipped classroom. Let us remember that in here, it implies that my students have to watch something and they have to make questions. And I have to address the questions and I have to remind them of what they are doing, right? And if they do not make the questions, teachers, because it is likely this may happen, then I can guide them or I can give them a very specific direction so they can get to know what I want them to do. So this is a little bit about the flipped classroom. Now, let's see the nasty part of this. How to flip the class? Because this may be the question. How can I do this? And I love this part. It has to be meaningful and it has to have a purpose. Oh, how wonderful. That is what they are expecting from my class. What is this telling me, teachers? If it says that this has to be meaningful, it means that my content has to be given in such a way my students see the logical part. I have said this a lot of times, and I will say it again. Teachers, remember to see the context. If we're talking about food, let's find a way of making sure that my students understand the part of food. If I'm speaking about transportation, yeah, let's make a comparison in the transportation in places like Quito, Ambato, Santa Elena, Guayaquil, place. Don't test my Ecuadorian geography. I'm not very good. Yeah, but I can start making certain comparisons so they can start, you know, being more responsible in this part. But on the other hand, I said that this is learner-centered, which means that my students are expected to, one, not watch everything as a couch potato, but get some meaning. If they don't know how to do it, I have to guide them. Yeah. Two, they have to make connections. Teachers, if they make connections, then we're right exactly where we want them to be. And this means that I have to show them examples. If I'm speaking about a phrasal verb, I have to find a video where they are using a phrasal verb. If I want them to use a very specific grammar form, I have to show them anyway when they can see that part in action. So again, this can be meaningful, this can have a purpose, and my students can make meaning. Yeah, I can have my students, they should be able to understand concepts at a deeper level. What's the meaning of this, teachers? Not memorizing, because memory works for a very limited time, but understanding how to use it. How can they show me that they understand? By using it. And that, teachers, is called application. Application is a word that we also saw with the video from the teacher, so that they can apply. If it is a strategy, if it is pronunciation, if it is grammar, they have to show me, not via an exercise. That would be the simplest form, but via a short video that they make, via a short text that they write, via a conversation where they can show me that they can use it, right? And of course, they have to have certain practice in, one, making questions, because it's not so easy to make a question, and two, in answering questions. Of course, teachers, the big word in here, so this can happen, is a word that not everybody likes. Let me see if I don't make a mess of this. Yeah, but, ooh, well, saved by the bell. So teachers, which is a solution for this? Just like the late Desmond Llewellyn told Pierce Brosnan in his last appearance in James Bond, the world is not enough. Well, I told you, I made a mistake. Sorry. No, the eraser is not active, so, well, I'm sorry. Always have a plan. Teachers, if you have a plan, then you know how to do this. If you want your students to have a look at a given video, you have to know the video. You have to know how long it is. You have to have certain keywords, certain questions, so they can respond to that. Yeah, and remember that at certain point, my students should be open to receive support and explanation, because sometimes they don't want to. They don't want to accept that they do not understand. So in here, they should be. But anyway, if they are not so open for letter D, I give my explanation in such a way I address most of the needs. This is why, as I said before, as a teacher, I have to watch my students. Let us continue. So, how to flip the class? I have to look at this. Clear, meaningful content. I'm not resolving anything, I know. I have to have objectives that are clear, and I love this word, that I can actually achieve, attainable objectives. So teachers, sometimes we tend to write objectives that are like very beautiful. The question is, can they be met? Yes or no. If they cannot, how can I make them met? Right? Because that is part of all my planning. These teachers would be a very important thing, especially when I'm working online. Yeah, Shakespeare in Hamlet said, brevity is the soul of wit. So I have to be brief. Let's forget about the anecdotes. Let's forget about too many examples. Let's go straight and to the point. And of course, if my students watched the video before, then chances are I can go to very specific examples. Teachers, let's be as clear and simple as possible, because this is going to enable my students to have better opportunities for understanding. And last but not least, we have to invite them again and again and again to watch the video and to be a part of this. So this will be like the general guidelines on how to flip the class. Yeah, and things to remember, my students have to watch, they have to summarize what they watch, and they are expected to make questions out of that. So this would be what I am expecting. And at this point, I insist, it looks nice, but again, I am sure that we have a question. How do I flip my class? Because all of this looks really nice, right? My students have to be active, yeah, I told you. They have to be participative, yeah, I told you. They have to share knowledge, yeah, I mentioned that. And in here, they are expected to, and I love this acrostic, look at this. T for think, W for, oh, I'm sorry. T for think, W for write, I for infer, R for read, L for listen, and S for speak. This would be like the main idea. So at this point, everything looks like, yeah, it makes a lot of sense. We still have a question. How do we flip? Here we go. One, choose the lesson. This is important. Teachers, which is going to be my condition for choosing my lesson? Answer, simple. I have to know from your, well, you have to know from your experience, which it would be one lesson in which you need to explain things over and over and over to your students, something that may be difficult to them. Yeah, something that may imply a lot of time in delivering. Something that may generate a lot of discussion, or perhaps something where, yeah, you need them to show you something. So this, teachers, is going to be based entirely on your experience with your students based on the content. Yeah, does flipping apply to the teaching? Yes, it does. The answer has to be yes. Yeah, because we have to at a certain point. The question is, what do we flip? Yeah. So in here, Paul Braddock is telling us, number one, don't flip all the time. Because if we tell students, okay, watch the video. What do I do? Watch the video, watch the video, watch the video. Then students are going to be bored because they say, oh, yeah, I know what they want to do. They want me to watch the silly video. Yeah. Teachers, I don't know if you have noticed, but at every point during this session, I have told you what I am doing. And I have attempted to tell you why I am doing this. And this, teachers, is an example of modeling, because we have to explain our students what's going to happen so they know. And we have to tell them what we expect them to do so they also know. Yeah, and well, the next part is just an advice, don't worry. And this would be, of course, what we have to do. Experiment, reflect, and adapt. Teachers, yet we have the question, how do I flip my class? Let me change my screens one more time. And let me give you a practical example. Let's say that I am teaching with my book. And let's go to the grammar lesson, because I said it was grammar, right? I know I said it was grammar. And let's say that we're going to be talking, this is going to be my class, comparatives and superlatives, right? So this is what I'm going to teach, and this is what comes to the book. So it says if I have one, two, three or more syllables, active ending, superlative, and I have my examples. And I have some examples on when to use the usage note, yeah, when to use ER or EST, etc. If I have irregular adjectives and etc. So all of this is what I am going to teach. Yeah, so I know this part. This comes in my book. So what if, because if you noticed, yeah, and before I get back here, let me change my screen one more time. Please notice, I'm going to let you watch a few more seconds. Have a look at this.
Now the students outside of class preload the content. They get the information they're going to need for class.
Teachers, please notice everything is done by hand. Everything is handmade. I don't know if she was the one who did the writing. It seems to me, because this looks very much like a girl's handwriting, slanted to the left, very analytical. Yeah, and please notice how she changes slides.
They can pause, rewind, and rewatch the videos as many times as they need to. They can post questions online to their classmates or to the teacher. And it's a self-paced program where they can be remediated by going back and reviewing former topics, or they can work ahead when they've already mastered a concept and are ready to look forward. They get the content here before class, so that when they come into class, my whole classroom has now shifted, where I'm at the center of the class, working between these differentiated groups focused on different pieces of application. I can now work between each of these groups that are moving at their own pace. This has created a 90% use of class time spent on application of the content, and 10% of class time is spent on delivery of content.
There we go.
When I can answer questions that have been posted or take any other questions that have come up from applying the content.
Notice she is changing the slides. So what is this telling me? The teacher is the one that has to make the video. As simple as that. Why do you have to make the video yourselves, teachers? Because as I told you before, it is your point of view, it is your learning style, it is your choice, and it is the materials that you choose. Yeah, the benefit, what happens if I was telling you, I showed you comparatives and superlatives, and you would have to make a video. That may be a little bit, you know, stressful at a certain point. Yeah, but if I all of a sudden,
hello, I'm Mike. Today's grammar topic is comparatives and superlatives. Two big words, but don't worry. We'll explain what they both mean to you in this part of our show. First, let's talk about comparatives.
So in here, Mike has around 8 minutes to explain everything to me, which means that I can sit down and I can watch everything that comes on the screen. I can listen to Mike. I can see the examples, and I can watch this as many times as I want, right? So what am I doing? I'm not doing the video. I'm not creating anything. I'm not making the video. I'm sorry. Yeah, but at the same time, I am deciding what I want to do. Remember, I told you, choose your lesson. If your grammar lesson, if your pronunciation lesson, if your phrases lesson is simple, forget it. Teach it. Don't worry. But if it is a little bit complicated, then maybe you would like to consider flipping it as a possibility, right? This would be like part of AVA. So in here I have, it says, 5 things I wish I knew before flipping my class. I think that now you're maybe thinking about this. It takes more time than you think. Yes, it does. Why? Because you have to plan. You have to look at your book. You have to select the material. You have to watch the video. You have to pick up some questions. Yet, teachers, you may have everything that you need. And if I may say, it takes more time than you think at the very beginning. But the more you go practicing, the better you get. Maybe you have heard that it says something like practice makes perfect, right? And it makes a lot of sense. I heard from a very wonderful speaker some years ago that practice does not make perfect. It makes consistent. And if I am consistent, I have to practice. And if I have to practice, I know exactly how it works. And it's going to be easier for me. Teachers, the best part of being a teacher is the experience that we get from teaching our students. The worst part of being a teacher is that sometimes we have to learn something new. On the same way that they say that doctors are the worst patients, some people say that teachers are the worst students. Teachers, this is a new world. This is a new era. And this is one thing that we have to do. Don't worry. It is possible. Materials. Why not? Because they design their materials their style. You have your own style. Yet we may expect certain negative reactions from our students. Well, you know that sometimes they get in the time when they complain about everything, but in the end, you are the teacher, you are in charge, you are the boss. End of the story. Yet, as I was telling you, a teacher should always be open to learning. A teacher is constantly learning. One of the best teachers I've ever had, who died some years ago, told me, you know, I think that the only time when I'm not going to be learning is when I die, he said. And yet, I think that is one experience that I can learn a lot from. Unfortunately, he laughed, I cannot teach anybody that. Unless, of course, I go and haunt somebody. But anyway, teachers, be open. Yeah, it's not going to hurt. We're going to learn a lot. And teachers, I messed everything up when I was trying to scribble it, but always have a plan. Barbara Taylor, the best teacher I've ever had, told me, an effective teacher always has an extra plan, always has an alternative, always has an additional worksheet, an additional activity, a joke, a video, something. And teachers, yeah, I believe her. Yeah, Barbara has a lot of experience. She's a great teacher, and I believe in that. So teachers, this means that we always have to have a plan, and the plan is very simple, teachers. Let me show you. Well, be patient with me. So far, so good. If my students do this, then I have the following reply or activity. If my students cannot do this, not so bad. Then I have these choices. I hope it makes sense. It's very simple, teachers. If, then. And it is just a matter of applying a little bit of your experience with your students and, you know, making like this mental plan, because you don't have to write that much. Okay. So 21st century skills, teachers, yes. We are no longer in the times when we started worrying, oh my God, the 2YK and things are going to go. No, teachers, this is 2020. Actually, teachers, this is nearly the end of 2020. We have been locked up probably since March. Yeah, probably, probably since April, but we have been locked up. But yet, my job is to teach. My job is to deliver content, and that's what I do. Yeah, and here, teachers, this is another explanation of Bloom's taxonomy. I want my students to do a lot of things, but teachers, very simple. If I want my students to apply what they learned, first they have to understand. If I want them to understand, first they have to remember. And if I can use my all the elements in technology to work, then I have a benefit. If I don't know how to use it, I can always ask somebody. My son is sitting just about 2 meters away from me. He speaks very good English and he's listening to everything. And sometimes when I make a joke, he laughs. When I gave the example of that video that he had to watch, he actually rolled his eyes up. Yeah, and if there is anything that I do not know how to do with technology, I turn to him or to his older sister, because this is what we do. We have to learn, as simple as that. Yeah, so this is what I was telling you. And teachers, I love this one because this is what we have to do. Teachers, it is already year 2020, so we have to update a little bit. Yeah, we have to be thinking about a lot of things. We have to do a little bit of research. We have to use the web. We have to sit down, yeah, and learn something new. But remember, teachers, learning is not about technology. Learning is about learning. Education is about education. My students are not going to learn because I use a lot of technology. They are going to learn because I give them the information, the content, the instruction, the strategies, the support, and the feedback. That, teachers, is my job as a teacher. As simple as that. So it's a very simple thing. Let us remember, yeah, right now working with technology is a life skill. So, well, let's make it a life skill and let's go for it. As simple as that. But teaching is teaching, and the teacher is always a teacher. Yeah. So Crystal Kish says, there is no one flipped classroom. In other words, there is not only one way. What you have to do is start applying this modality, see how it works, evaluate that, reconstruct it, and go for it again. Yeah, remember that your students are going to be the best peers because they're going to tell you if it is working or not. When in doubt, ask somebody. Teachers, remember, work as a team so we can survive, as simple as that. And well, last but not least, the late Schultz, and I am proud enough to tell you that I sent him a birthday card just a week before he died in 2000. He had a very good phrase. Teachers, don't worry that much about this. In the end, you have your own style. So be yourself. If you're yourself, nobody can say that you're doing wrong. It is your style. Be open for learning. Yeah, and have that in mind. You know the content. You know the strategies. All you have to do now is use a little bit of technology to deliver it. Yeah, the following are some of the references that I used. A little bit of extra dev references. Yeah, and teachers, this is when I say thank you very much for your time. I'm going to stop sharing my screen so we can go to questions if there is.